I am very pleased to announce that Jackson Baker is going to be coming up to talk to us about the making of skis.
Hello, everybody. My name is Jackson Baker, and I'll be talking to y'all today about multiple aspects of skiing and making skis. I started skiing at a mere 3 years old. I was little, but I could shred. They say your first turn shows how good of a skier your child will be. Sounds legit, right? One problem, I didn't turn. Turning wasn't in my vocabulary. Mind you, I didn't have a very big vocabulary at that age. Because skiing is my passion, I decided to dedicate my Masterix project to it. For my project, I decided to focus on how to build a pair of skis that suited me. And these skis sit next to me now. But I'll be talking about much more than just that today. I completed my goal, and now I also know a lot about the technology behind skis. I'll be sharing my newfound knowledge with all of you in a way I hope you can understand. But first, let's go back to when I was still learning and what led me to where I am now. I grew up skiing at Whistler with my family. When I was 10, I completed my level 6 star test at Whistler, which is the last ski school level. After completing ski school, I tried out for what is called the Roundhouse program. The significance of this picture is the place behind me is the Roundhouse. This is where we'd meet every morning. This is the first place you'd see once you got to the top of the mountain, and where I spent a lot of time. The Roundhouse program is a program for young skiers who've completed level 6. You can choose one of three paths: racing, terrain park skiing, or MAP. Believe it or not, I was a racer. For 2 years, actually, until I realized it wasn't for me. I was the slowest in the group. Want to know why? I was skiing backwards most of the time, or doing 360s of side hits. Worst of all, I had twin tip skis, the worst nightmare for a racing coach. They were the least raceable ski ever. The one day I tried skiing with the Whistler Freeride Club, that day I said to myself, bye racing, and hello, Big Mountain. Now, Big Mountain isn't this, or this. Big Mountain is this. I pretty much just huck my meat off any cliff or drop or cornice and try to make it look good while doing it. Most of the time, I think it does, doesn't it? Anyways, I started competing in Big Mountain, and that's when my skiing really took off. I'll explain a little bit how Big Mountain competitions work. Most competitions take place over 4 days. When you compete, you try to qualify for finals day. If you make the finals, then you have to ski like crazy to try to take the win. Unlike racing, it's not the fastest time that wins. In Big Mountain ski competitions, judges watch each skier go down and give them points in 5 categories: line choice, control, fluidity, technique, and style and energy. Competing's crazy. Everybody's just sending it onto hard pack. To be honest, my first competition was terrible. I squeezed into the finals by qualifying dead last. Then, on my first turn on my finals run, my ski popped off, and I tomahawked head over heels 8 times down the venue. It probably looked something like this. Now, luckily, this is not me, and the guy did survive, and now he's a pro skier. Big Mountain skiing is pretty tough and involves a lot of risk. One thing that is quite possibly harder than skiing itself is buying the right gear. What I look for in skis is skis with camber. Skis with camber look like the skis on the bottom. Skis with camber carve much nicer and make it easier to ski in hard snow. When you land in hard pack snow, they bounce back much nicer. Rocker skis, which look like the skis on the top, they're much easier to ski and they float very nicely in deep powder because of their raised tips. When I decided that I wanted to build a pair of skis for my Masterix project, I didn't know where to start. My dad suggested I contacted a man by the name of Johnny Chilton, the owner and founder of Foon Skis, an ex-professional skier. My dad had heard of Johnny through his connection with the CEO of Mountain Equipment Co-op, or MEC. MEC is Foon's biggest buyer. Every year they place an order, and that order is getting bigger and bigger each year. I contacted Johnny, and we arranged to meet last summer. I talked to him, and he agreed to help me achieve my crazy idea. It proved to be not as crazy as I thought. I went up to Johnny's shop 4 times between December and January, and by the end, I had my very own pair of skis. It was an amazing experience to work on this project with such an incredible and talented person. As I said already, Johnny Chilton is an ex-professional skier from Whistler. As a professional skier, Johnny accomplished some challenging lines and skied some impressive mountains. Some of his accomplishments have been descending Mount Deborah in Alaska, University Peak in the Wrangell Range, and the iconic east face of Mount Tantalus, just south of Whistler. Johnny was a cabinet maker before becoming a ski maker, which is how he gets his strong work ethic, and is such a good handyman. He founded Foon Skis in 2011. The company got its name from Johnny's nickname, Foon. Johnny works hard to make his skis as eco-friendly as possible. The wood he uses for his cores are local to the West Coast and can even be found behind his house. Not only is it good for the environment, but it's good wood as well. All the big machines in Johnny's shop, he either bought used or he built himself. Johnny is also the only person who works in his shop. All his skis are handmade, so he's there for every part of the construction process. Johnny said to me, "I want to make skiing more like surfing, where you can feel the difference between a handmade board versus a factory-made one." It was a privilege to be welcomed into Johnny's shop and to be involved in the process of making my own pair of skis. The first step on the hands-on part of making skis is putting an ultra-high weight molecular polyethylene on, or UHMWP, on the base layer, or the core temp layer jig. The UHMWP is a thing you see at the bottom of a pair of skis when you flip them over, and it sometimes had designs on it. We then used pre-made edges which hadn't been sandblasted yet, which we sanded by hand to remove any oils or bacteria, causing the edges to be harder to bond to the ski. We cut the edges to the desired size, then for extra support, we glued the edges onto the base layer before the epoxy. Epoxy is a very strong glue used in all skis. Then we left it to dry for 2 hours. In order to have strong enough edges which are still able to flex, they need to be heated to Rockwell 48. Rockwell is the metal hardened scale for all metals, including massive bridges spanning vast oceans. Rockwell 48 is how hard they can be while still able to bend without breaking. The next step was to use a CNC machine. This machine cuts out channels in the wood for the sidewalls. A CNC machine is a really big machine that needs a software on a computer to work. You must set in the coordinates on the computer to cut the channels. Sidewalls are liquid when you pour them into the core, and then they harden. Most of the major ski companies glue their sidewalls onto the core, but that can be dangerous, causing the sidewalls to be less strong. A sidewall is for extra protection on your skis and better edge grip. The core is possibly the most important part of the ski. Foon Skis uses a wood core made of yellow cedar. One thing that makes Foon Skis so unique is how close the wood comes from in relation to where the skis are made. What I mean by this is yellow cedar is only found on the West Coast, and Mount Currie in Pemberton is covered in it. Not many ski companies use wood cores because it can cause a lot of chatter or shaking on icy slopes. Yellow cedar channels and tames a lot of that energy coming from the edges on the hard snow so that the ski glides nicer on sharp corners. Originally, Johnny used fir inside of his skis instead of yellow cedar. But since he was a cabinet maker, he had previously used yellow cedar and liked the feel of it. He decided to try using it in his skis. He got people to try out the skis, including him. Everyone loved them, and so did he. He also likes it because it has a really smooth flex, and it's very damp. It absorbs a lot of vibration to reduce chatter in hard corners. These qualities translate into a really smooth ride. As I said before, yellow cedar is also local. All the wood Johnny gets for his cores is a 2x8-inch sheet. He cuts a 2x8 piece of wood in half, giving them the same flex properties. That means a pair of skis would be identical, but a different pair would have a slightly different flex and weight depending on the tree the core came from. The wood needs to be air dried for 1 month prior to working with it. In the following image, the cores are being cut to size. The actual core is sitting on top of the big wooden piece. You can also see the green sidewall along the edge. Right there. Next, we had to start laying the materials on a metal sheet for the press. The first material is the base layer. We sprayed the top of the two bases with contact cement for even more protection. At this point, the edges are already on the base layer, as I stated already. Then we mixed the epoxy and spread it in the middle of the base layer and on the edges. We made sure the epoxy got in between the edges for a strong hold. A major difference between Fünskis and the big companies is that the big companies have a machine which would put all the epoxy on instead of doing it by hand. So the edges have more of a tendency to rip out. The carbon Kevlar stringer, or stomp pad, is placed where the bindings will eventually go. The stomp pad is for stiffening the skis but keeping the tip and tail flexible. Adding the stomp pad helps with landing on hard-packed snow. Biaxial fiberglass goes over top of this. Biaxial fiberglass is two layers stitched together, appearing to be almost see-through and very lightweight, making the ski stiffer but still light. After that, we put the yellow cedar core on. Wood cores are fairly new inventions, as ski cores used to be metal or synthetic. As I said before, the core is arguably the most important part of a ski, because if a core rattles too much on icy conditions, it could cause for an unenjoyable ride. We put the same material as the base layer, UHMWP, onto the tip and tail. Only the one we put on the tip and tail is double the strength to make it practically impossible to snap, which is right down there. We lay carbon only on the tail, then fiberglass to add flex. You want a more flexible tail to be able to land with your weight back and not be kicked forward from the stiffness. That's also why you want the tail to be strong, so when you do land or slip back on your tails, they don't snap, which can happen. Then we put down the chop strand mat for the bindings to be screwed into. They use the same material for drilling diving boards into pools, because it's very strong, yet thin and light. And that is the chop strand mat right there. Then we lay the top sheet that has all the designs on it over top. This sheet is made of nylon, and it's one of the most expensive parts of the ski. Johnny orders these from Washington, so when he receives them, they already look exactly like you see here. In case you're wondering, the skis are named after his son Ty, and his own nickname Foon, hence the Ty Foon. He has four other models of skis, which each with their own top sheet design. We then put a metal sheet over top of everything. We made sure that epoxy is in between each layer, which holds everything together. Now the skis are sandwiched by two metal sheets and ready for the press. We put the skis in a bag and slid them into the press. We filled the bag full of air and heated the skis to 70 degrees Celsius and then left them in the press for 2 hours. We then turned off the heat after an hour. This photo is what the ski press looks like. As you can tell, it kind of looks homemade. That's because it is. Johnny made the press all by himself. The press shapes the ski to make it look like it does. We then cut the extra epoxy and anything that has spilled out from the skis after the press. We started cutting out the tip and tail first. Only a quarter of the sidewall stays on the ski and the rest gets cut off. My dad uses the grilled cheese analogy to explain making sandwich skis. Because when you take them out of the press, the epoxy, or cheese, oozes out from the sides, and both skis and grilled cheese are beautiful things. The photos here are the two skis tucked together and me cutting out the skis. We then used a sanding machine to get the rest of the epoxy off the edges. You know you reach the edge when it starts sparking. We then used a different sanding machine to get the epoxy off the bases. This machine works quite similar to the one to the left, because you sand it down until it sparks, and then you know the edges and bases are at the same height. Then we used a stone grinder to grind the bases down to the same height as the edges with perfection. It does take a few minutes, so while waiting for the stone grinder to work its magic, we started standing the next ski. We then hand beveled the edge 1 degree off the snow, and then we used a beveling machine as well. What this does is when you ski straight, the edges don't touch the snow. But when you turn, you get edge gripping on the snow. Finally, we ran a diamond stone along the edge to sharpen it and for a clean finish, making the skis ready for use. Finally, it was time to test out the skis. And they were awesome. This winter was pretty great, and my skis were a big contributing factor. Unfortunately, it wasn't quite what I wanted for competition, but that's what next year's for, right? I think this year I progressed more than I have in the past. I accomplished a lot too. I skied multiple lines that I've always looked at and wondered if they're possible. Surprisingly, they were. In this photo, I'm just sending it right before competing. I have a concept for sticking my comp run. That is, if I crash enough before, I won't crash in my run. So the snow at Red Mountain was so beautiful, I didn't even think of crashing this, and I stuck this landing. And of course, I ended up crashing in my comp run. In this picture, I'm hiking this gnarly hike at Whistler. Like, I mean gnarly. The rock was like this close to your head. So at one point, I actually ducked underneath the rock, and we had to jump over a little dip onto this ice, this wall here that these guys are trying to climb up. Oh yeah, and below us was a 300-foot cliff. Fun stuff. Was it worth it, you might ask? I'd say yes. That leads nicely into the next photo. This was a ski down after the tough hike. I think this photo is self-explanatory. In this photo, I'm just hucking a 360 around and barely missing a ski tree while skiing out as my bud Seth is trying to climb down an ice wall over there. Overall, this year really delivered. There was so much snow, which made it way more fun to land and crash for that matter. I accomplished a lot of work during the limited time I spent at Finskis, taking lots of notes and pictures, and going through the process of building skis. The steps to building a pair of skis is crazy. So much time and effort is put into the skis, and one wrong move, and they could be ruined. The level of detail and discipline to create a pair of skis is immense. And Johnny is a true craftsman when it comes to this topic. I'm very pleased that I now get a ride on my skis. They're amazing in almost every condition, yet they're still light. I'm so happy with what I've accomplished and how the skis turned out. I can't believe Johnny's never-ending knowledge of this topic and of skiing in general. I'm very grateful for Johnny's help and for dedicating so much time towards me and my project. Here's a video of me making my skis and me shredding on them. On that note, I want to say thanks to multiple people. Thanks to my external advisor, Johnny Chilton, for helping me build my skis and answering all my questions. Thanks to my internal advisor, Laura Meager, for editing my paper and keeping me on topic. Thanks to Callum Fraser for editing my video and letting me use his computer. And last, but definitely not least, thank you, Mom and Dad, for always making me do work, even if I didn't want to. And thank you, audience, for listening. I hope it was interesting.
I am very pleased to announce that Mr. Jackson Baker has met all the requirements of the Master's program at Arts.